Hello, so we are back after some Wi-Fi connection problems, but so I'm here with this amazing person I met here in New York City, Geraldine Abergas, and thank you so much for doing this with me.
Thank you for having me.
And instead of me trying to say who she is and what she does, I'm going to ask her, even though she's very humble, I'm going to ask her to introduce herself and talk a little bit about what she does.
And that's the toughest question. People ask me that all the time, and it's hard for me to explain. But my name is Geraldine Abergas. I'm a body worker, massage therapist, wellness practitioner, and I have a bicoastal practice. I work in New York City and now Los Angeles as of last year. And I guess that's it.
I like when you told me the first time that a client told you alignment therapist. I really like that. We are going to talk a little about that
too.
So I know you have a degree in biology and chemistry.
Yes.
That you have worked in from a doctor's office and hospitals, and I know because we talk a lot, not as much as I would like, so, but yes, about your holistic lifestyle and holistic approach with your clients. So how did that switch happen?
Well, I think it's an ongoing process. I have a strong background working in healthcare. I worked, as you mentioned, in a hospital setting and a doctor's office setting for many years. Since I was a little girl, maybe since I was 13 years old, I worked at a hospital and I used to volunteer as a candy striper. But the switch happened around, I would say, early 2000 when I decided to go to school for massage therapy. I made a complete switch in my career after working in the hospital setting for over a dozen years, and I wanted to get more involved in integrative healthcare, when at that point it wasn't quite as popular. You know, this is early 2000. And working in oncology and working in pharmaceuticals especially, I knew that there was a lot more that we can do in terms of healing and the healing process other than medicine or surgery. However, you know, there's a place for Western medicine, and I just felt like, you know, naturally we have more of a innate ability to heal. And this is the journey that I've been on ever since then, especially since my own experience. In late 1998, I was in a car accident, and I always say that it was the accident that brought me into this field, and I say that accident happened on purpose. So, you know, in my own healing process, I found massage therapy and also yoga to be what helped me heal the most.
It was a serious accident, right?
It was, you know, it's something that I probably have carried for a long time, you know, since then. I would say just in the recent year or so that I really feel relieved from the burden of that accident. It had a lot of effect on me psychologically, emotionally, and physically. I was, it was a rear impact upon which my hip was dislocated and multiple fractures in the pelvis and also loss of consciousness. So, you know, after that moment, when I remember waking up from the accident in the emergency room, I just felt like a different person. And everything that I knew for my life up until that point felt foreign to me. And the first thing I did, like when I did get out of the hospital, I was in there for a couple weeks, you know, I was in a wheelchair, I had to relearn how to walk. It's been such a journey, and it's amazing at this point for me to look back at what I've been through. And I don't think many people know that I have been through that. You know, when people see me now, they sort of don't understand my own process, because I don't really share much about myself, especially in a client setting, because I'm there for my clients. So I don't normally talk about my process, so which is why I'm really excited about today, because I get to share some things with others. So thank you for having me.
No, thank you. And we are going to go back to this, because this just brings me to a parallel. Like Philip said, Philip, my husband, he had cancer probably like 10 years ago, and he has been very healthy, very good, complaining a lot still about little things, but that's a man thing, right? But he says it was the worst thing and the best thing that ever happened to his life, right? And I kind of have that feeling from you.
Yes.
And I have the feeling from like leaving Brazil probably 7 years ago and being in this tough city that is New York City and trying to understand the world from a different perspective through a lot of pain, yes. I have to say. And that just brings more knowledge. So many things happen to our lives that in the moment we don't like, oh my God, what is this about? But time comes around.
Yeah, it's almost like when things happen to us, it's hard for us to make sense out of it. And you can get caught up in how it makes you feel, or you can take that experience and help it transform you. Because I think that's really our purpose here in this world, is to be able to experience life in a way that helps us develop and also elevate our perspective of what life is. So I'm so grateful for everything that's happened in my life, and I wouldn't change a thing just because of where I am today.
Yes. And before I get into the first question, I still want to say one thing. This brings me back what I've told you a few times, like towards my posture. My posture used to be so bad. It's so much better. Thank you so much, Geraldine. I wouldn't be in this level if I haven't met you before. And posture is going to be one of the topics, so don't miss it. My first question that I planned was a little based on the interview I gave to the Brazilian channel some time ago, that comparing our ancestors to our lifestyle nowadays, that most of people are sitting down long hours during the day and with a load of stress. And then how is that stress being translated in our body physically and mentally? But let's start with the physical aspect. What's going on?
Okay, so stress is a very broad topic. You know, there are so many different aspects of stress. We can talk about physiological, emotional, environmental, our nutrition, so many things. But if we were to just talk about physical stress in terms of posture, is that what you want to discuss, posture, or in terms of just lifestyle?
Let's see. Because I kind of wanted to say one thing before, and that would have directed the question a little bit better. So the stress, we are sitting down and getting all that stress load, and the body understands the stress like you're in danger. Mm-hmm. And then you're sitting down and you have like your butt is off, your abs is off, you can't run away, and your body understands you gotta run away because you're in danger, but you're not in danger, you're sitting down under stress. So what happens that physically to the body?
Well, we're not meant to sit for long periods of time. If we were to just talk structurally as to what happens after sitting for long periods, you know, besides tight hips, forward head positioning, internal rotation of your shoulders, we can also discuss how it impacts your breathing. So in a normal posture where your chest is naturally open and you have greater access to your sort of breath through your diaphragm, when you're in a sitting position or a seated position, we tend to compress that area. And we also then will shorten these muscles that are naturally meant to be more open and flexible and viable. So when you sit for long periods of time, you can imagine all of your muscles that are sort of shortened, you know, your hip flexors and, like I mentioned, even your neck and your pecs. They tend to get short and tight just because you're being held in that position for a very long time. And then afterwards, you know, when we get up and try to move, we're sort of fixed in that seated position because we're seated for so long. And our bodies aren't meant to be sitting for long periods. But I'm not one to suggest to anyone in terms of how to sit. Is a standing desk better? The most important thing is to move often and move well.
Yes. When Geraldine said hip flexors, she means the muscles more in front of the hips and
yes.
the front of the thighs. Some people don't understand that. When she started explaining these things to me, I was like, oh my God, but I have all those muscles tight, the front of the legs, the front of the chest, some muscles around the neck, right? And it's crazy how this position tends to get more and more like worse, I guess. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of a pattern somehow, right? When you start looking around, there is a pattern.
There sure is a pattern. I mean, if you were to just look around, and let's say you're at the train station, you're looking at everyone standing there, everyone's on their phone and heads leaning forward, the phone's down here, and it's even uncomfortable for me to do that, but you can see how people's posture are changing, you know, as we are in this you know, technology age. We're committed to our computer screens, we're committed to our phone screens. So we're not even looking up or looking around as we should be. So it tends to harbor tighter neck muscles and pec muscles. But, you know, you always say worse and bad. I hear you say this. And I'm saying this now because I know people are going to be listening. When you start labeling things and putting things in categories as good and bad, it your body responds to your relationship with it. So if our relationship with it is saying, like, my bad shoulder or my bad hip or this posture is bad, it's never say bad. It is what it is in that moment, and it's something that gives us an opportunity to correct or address. So we need to be kinder to our bodies. Our body does what we ask it to do, and it supports us in our lives. So, you know, just be kinder to it.
She always slaps me in the face like this, but I like it, you know, I learned so much out of it. I want to add the point that a lot of people, when I talk about posture, or, you know, they have this idea, I used to have this idea that it's genetic, right? Mm. There is a predisposition in some cases,
sure,
right? You can talk about that. Mm-hmm. But there is so much you can do to improve your posture,
yes,
right?
You know, there's, I think when people say that there's, it's hereditary, let's say, our genes are not fixed. Our lifestyles are what we sort of pick up from our parents. So if our parents are not active people, perhaps we're going to grow up with inactive lifestyles. So in that sense, you know, we can say genetic in that way. But when we look at our genes and our bodies, we're a lot more fluid than we think we are. You know, when we consider people who have medical conditions, like my mom and my mother's side of the family is very strong in diabetes, it doesn't necessarily mean that I'll get diabetes, but I certainly have a predisposition to it. But if I, you know, be mindful of my lifestyle behaviors, it's not to say that I too will get diabetes. So I just believe that genes are a lot more fluid, and our genetics are a lot more fluid, and we have a lot more power and control than most people think we do. You know, so I think we need to get out of that paradigm of thinking that, you know, what our parents are or how our parents are is how we're going to be.
It's great you're saying this, because so much people say all the time, oh, it's genetic. Oh, it's genetic. I used to be very toned. Like, not all the time. I went through my, like, when I was a teenager, I was overweight, and then whatever happened. Then I was very fit. Then I had the baby and I looked terrible after the baby, and it's fine. It's fine. Then I conquered a good body again, but some people didn't know me before. And then when I go talk to them, they're like, ah, it's genetics. And it's not genetics. It's lifestyle
it's
that you
work.
Can change. Hard work.
Yeah.
Healthy
it's a commitment.
Habit. Exactly.
Yeah.
And we are going to talk about this other aspect of the of the hard work, that we are going to talk about the cold showers and breathing, because I'm 36 years old now and I'm playing handball for New York City, and I can run faster than a lot of 20 years old girls, but I don't think I was that good when I used to play back in Brazil. It's just my posture is better, my breathing is better. Thank you so much. The work Geraldine does on me, releasing the muscle and making my body more mobile, it's amazing. I'm performing much better. And this is great, because so many people don't have an idea that they can improve so much, like in a sport they do, or like just on their everyday, you know, their everyday activities, or just how much breathing can improve their capacity of feeling well with themselves. And we are going to talk about breathing too. I'm going to cheat here a little bit because I have a prescript of what we are going to talk, and I don't want to skip anything. So let's go back to the stress. Right, we are under stress, overwork, and sitting down, getting tighter. But Geraldine told me that once, you're not under stress only at work. Then you get home and watch the news on TV, or then you're gonna post something on Facebook and you're so nervous about it. We are kind of like in this leap of stress all
yes.
the time, leap or loop. I always mess it up in my English, sorry. So let's talk about that.
Yeah, you know, I think, especially in this day and age, they call it infodementia, and when we're bombarded with so much information, especially in the political culture now, I think a lot of people are so stressed out with what's happening, and we sort of take on too much information from outside that influences us. Now, how do we manage something like that when our lifestyle is sort of more conducive to do more all the time? You know, there's only 24 hours in a day, but yet we all want to work harder, do more, and our to-do list every day is getting larger and larger, especially for, you know, moms and families and people who have their own businesses, whatever it may be, or living in New York City especially. So when you look at that type of stress, we can't mitigate that. You know, we can't control any of that. So how do we manage when this stress load is so high? It really has to do with your relationship with yourself. It really has to do with what you do for yourself. I think for you, for example, you talk about your progress. Your greatest progress is that you've developed a better relationship with yourself. And yes, when you're able to do that and recognize what you need in the moment and know how to give yourself what you need in the moment, because you have a toolkit now, you know, whether it be breathing, cold showers, meditation, exercise, even speaking kinder to yourself and thinking nicer thoughts, you know, you have more tools to access. So in these moments that you're able to give yourself what you need. So it really comes down to the relationship you have with yourself.
Yeah, and I totally understand that. Like, I used to be so nasty to myself, like, I'm not good enough, I'm not trying hard enough, I gotta do this, I gotta do that, and kind of like being my worst enemy, dragging myself down. And that realization towards working with my profession too now as a personal trainer, it makes you realize that this is common, it goes all around, you know, like we don't turn off our minds. We are constantly thinking about things we gotta do, thinking we are not good enough because we haven't accomplished yet, or not being able to relax a little bit and become a little bit. That through you, I've learned that breathing and meditation and cold showers, so many things can help. And that is so important to help you learn how to keep the focus or even control the nervous system. That's one of the things I wanted to talk.
Yes.
So, first question before this other one. How does this stress or emotions, they become physical in the body?
Okay, that's a good question and also a very complicated question. In my experience with my clients and the body work that I do, you know, they say that 80% of physical pain or some number like that has an emotional component to it. We as human beings have an incapacity to sort of look at our emotions as a signal to act on something, and know that our bodies are such fine machines that when an emotion arises, it's really a signal to act on something. Yes. You know, whether we're angry or sad or afraid or happy, all of these things are natural emotions. And we are meant to either share it, express it, move through it. But when we don't do those things, they tend to get caught up in our body. So let's say somebody's scared, right? And all of a sudden you're in fear. The first thing you do is you take a short breath. Now, can you imagine if someone were to have a traumatic experience and they're startled? Now, in the body, it's going to show up in that manner. It's going to show up as in like tight pecs or however fear shows up in your body. If you're unable to move through or express or release that fear, it can then get trapped in your body. A lot of times I'll work with clients and we'll be performing a session and they may even be unaware as to areas of their body which emotions may be trapped, and we'll work or I'll be touching an area and there could potentially be an emotional release. And all of a sudden memories will come flooding their mind and there'll be some sort of reaction, whether it be sadness, grief, fear, memories, crying. It's natural. And what's really important when it comes to emotions is to be able to recognize them as not bad or good, but as something that's sort of prompting us to act, whether it be move or talk or share or hug. You know, that's really what emotions are. Again, you know, as a human being, we're so fine-tuned into what we do. I believe that everyone is just so divine that emotions are this special gift that we have to sort of signal to us in terms of how to act and how to connect with others. And people may not have an arena to share, or they may not be comfortable to share, or they may not know how to move through something, and that's when things get stuck.
With you, in one of our sessions, you made me realize too that I kind of started understanding that. For example, I think when I'm anxious, my chest get tight and my muscles around the neck get tight. Mm-hmm. You know, I feel it. I'm like, ugh. So this is very deep. I really would like to talk more about that.
Okay.
Hopefully when you come back to New York City. I'm gonna go back to stress a little bit and say about how much the stress can affect all of our systems, not only the muscular system, right? And not like the digestive system you were explaining to me. And that can make someone get like more problems to lose weight, for example. I'm not gonna say names. I have a client, she told me like, I recently noticed that when I'm gonna go do number two, I don't know how to say that in a different way. When I go do number two, I'm tight. And like, it's like your body's understanding you're in danger. And how are you gonna do number two if you're in danger, like a dinosaur coming after you?
Yeah, you know, again, stress is, I think, has gotten a bad rap. I think stress is something that is meant to protect us. And when we feel every single day that we're under this sort of stress, like we're in danger, our body is always prepared. It doesn't have an opportunity to relax or let go. And that's when you're able to do number two, right? When you're able to let go.
Yeah.
So it has a lot to do with that. And we can go more scientifically in terms of like the vagus nerve and how it's the largest nerve in the body and how it controls so many of your systems. And the vagus nerve directly is related to your breathing, because where it's located, it actually passes through your diaphragm. So let's say you're tense, you're afraid, you're unable to breathe, or you're not breathing properly, your diaphragm is locked. Essentially, you're going to have an inefficient vagus nerve. So that too affects your digestion. So I think sometimes if you're just able to gain access to your breath in a way that's not restricted, you can essentially improve your digestion.
And and this is very interesting. There is I've been focusing a lot on this posture, trying to be as aligned as I can with my clients. And I have a client that she had such great results right after we started correcting the position of her pelvis.
Mm-hmm.
But this can be to another time to reconnect. Okay, here we are again. So This is very familiar, as I started understanding this a little bit more, like the stress can lead, for example, the heart racing, poor digestion, as Geraldine was saying, or sometimes you can't even sleep because you keep thinking about something you gotta do and you're tense in your bed, can affect us in so many different ways.
Well, going back to your initial question about your ancestors, or our ancestors, those are all things that were put in place because we needed it. So let's say we were being chased by a tiger. You're not going to want to go to the bathroom. You are going to want your heart to be racing because you need to get the hell out of there. And your breathing is going to be more shallow because you also need to be in a heightened alert state. So that's why I believe that stress is getting such a bad rap, when stress is something that's protecting us, or supporting us. So, you know, our heart is racing because we need to act on something. But the thing with nowadays is that we think we're under stress when we're not really. And that has a lot to do, again, with your relationship with yourself. Like, are you able to identify when you're in danger and when you're not in danger? And I think that's really what we need to ask ourselves on a daily basis. Like, am I okay here? Like, okay, I'm okay.
Yeah, and you're right. Being able, because being stressed, it's okay, it's normal, right? You
it's
have
normal.
To go through it. But being able to calm down afterwards and bring your body to a normal state and calm state, I think
yes.
This is the challenge, right?
Yes, yes.
It's crazy, like talking to other people too, and to some of my clients, you hear stories like, can you believe from nowhere he just yelled at me for no reason? Then it's kind of like you make some questions. Does he exercise? Does he have a high stressful job? Does he live in New York City? Whatever it is. So some things kind of like you have these anger attacks a little bit more out of control, not because you mean to be mean to the other person, it's just because you're not being really able to deal with that load of stress, right? With that constant stress, now not learning how to turn it off a little bit.
Yes, and I think too that we've learned or we've adapted to being more reactionary to our surroundings as opposed to being, acting. So we're sort of like responding to our environment as opposed to responding as we want to in our environment. So, you can never control the guy that's cutting you off on the highway. See, I'm in LA now, so I can say that. Or if you're in New York City and there's somebody walking in front of you or that cut you off or hit you with their umbrella, now you can't control that. But when you're stable enough within yourself and you're centered enough within yourself, things like that don't bother you. Yes. So it's really, again, back to relationship with self.
I want to ask you something. So I feel this on me. When I'm under stress, I get the shallow breathing. We are going to talk more about breathing, but I get into the shallow breathing that I'm not even sure if I'm breathing. I am, because I didn't die yet. But it's crazy. How does this constant stress state can affect breathing?
Well, it's funny when I ask my clients, especially our first time session, and I ask them about the quality of their breath, they always tell me that their breath is good. I think you were one of them. And when I ask them to take a deep breath, they're like, like they can't even access their breath, or they're going straight into their chest. You can see their neck muscles tightening. Now, these are not your breathing muscles. I mean, they're certainly accessory muscles for breathing, but being able to engage more of your diaphragm in your breath and expanding the capacity that your lungs can take is really what we're looking for. Now, when stress is upon us, we tend to breathe more shallow, again, because we need to get somewhere. We need to get away from something. We need to act. So stress is giving us the sort of predisposition physically to be able to act, move, run quickly. But yet again, every single day, if we feel like we're under all this stress, we tend to just breathe in this area. And then the muscles get short, we're sitting for long periods of time, our brain doesn't know how to access our diaphragm anymore. They tend to just go to the muscles that are easy, because again, our body's going to do what we ask it to do. If it's just wanting to breathe, it's going to just use whatever is easiest, unless we train it to be more efficient and more optimal.
And it's very cool. We are going to talk about that. But if I ask you, if you're not using your diaphragm, what are the muscles that you're going to be using?
You're probably going to use your pec minor. You're going to use your scalenes.
Yes, and then these muscles are going to become tighter or
Shorter.
Hypertonic. Because the first time she told me this, I was like, she was naming all the muscles that are tight on me. And then I started realizing that I don't really breathe.
Most people don't.
And when I ask now my clients, like, do a big breath. Or during the group fitness class, it's like, do a big breath. Let's all breathe now. And, most of people don't know how to access the diaphragm and expand the rib cage, right? So if you could explain in an easy way. What is the
it's
not ideal?
I don't know if there's an easy way, because even when you ask someone to do abdominal breathing, that they tend to use their abdominal muscles. They'll push their belly out thinking that they're breathing abdominally, and it's not really optimal either. I just think that everyone breathes differently depending on their level of stress in that moment, depending on, is it morning, is it night, is it after a long day of sitting at work, is it right after a workout, is it after a yoga class? In all of these situations, our breathing is going to be different. I think, again, it needs to come back to your relationship with your breath. If you were to take a deep breath in this moment, you can ask yourself, what is the quality of my breath right now, and how can I improve it just a little bit? So I always ask my clients to imagine 360 degree breath, because you want to involve your rib cage. A lot of people can get the abdominal breath going, a lot of people can get into their chest, but yet there's no movement of the rib cage. And now our intercostals are also respiratory muscles. Our QL is also, or our lower back area is also breathing muscles. We also have muscles along the spine that are breathing muscles. And we have so many muscles that support us in breathing. However, we tend to just use the shortest, most easiest to access because we live this life where everything's go, go, go. So of course, our body's gonna say, okay, this is the easiest to get to, this is the fastest way we can get to this, so this is what we're gonna offer you. But when it comes down to trying to rest and digest and relax, are you able to access that breath? Are you able to get your rib cage to expand? And it should never be a forced experience either. Again, I ask my clients to take a deep breath wherever they are, and I ask them to just work towards improving it just a little bit and pay attention to that. I ask my clients every morning and every night to take 3 to 5 good breaths just so they can spend that moment, even if it's just a few minutes, checking in with themselves. And what better way to wake up and check in with yourself and check in with yourself before you go to bed? Because often, you know, what's the first thing we do when we wake up? It's like, don't you grab your phone? A lot of people grab their phone as soon as they wake up.
Yeah.
And if you were to just spend a little bit of time for yourself in the morning, just to check in where you are, how you're feeling, you can really course correct a lot for yourself.
Yes, and I'm gonna get to this now. Like, so what a better breathing pattern can do for someone, like in a physical state, more oxygen being delivered for your cells, more energy production. I don't know, how would that affect the muscles too? Could you explain a little bit towards physical, and then we are gonna get to the mental part.
No, I think the biggest difference I've seen in my clients who have gained greater access to their breath is the quality of tissue. Most of us walk around in a very rigid state, you know, whether we have high demands in life or we work out excessively. When I see them working on their breath or improving their breath, you can actually feel their body melting. You can feel the fascia melting. You can feel the muscles relaxing. And not to the point where it's inaccessible, but actually to a point where it's just relaxed. Like, our body should be able to find a relaxed state. And I think that's ultimately the goal for many people, is how to get your body to relax. Like, a lot of times, even in sessions, you know, if I'm trying to like lift somebody's arm, see them helping me, it's like they don't even know that they're tight or tense until someone else touches them. So I think back to the relationship itself, you know, really just checking in with how you feel. Am I relaxed in this moment? And am I breathing? Can I gain greater access to my breath in this moment?
Yeah, realizing, to me, was a big thing, realizing that I was shallow breathing most of the time. And as you said, like, after I started with the Wim Hof Method, that we are going to talk about it too, and the cold showers and the trying to train my breathing system. How you say it? Breathing system?
Respiratory
system. How everything is like becoming better, and not only with meditation too, that we are going to talk about, but the relationship with myself, being able to calm down, being able to relax these muscles. I need to relax to get a better posture and to function better. As an athlete too, like running so fast or being capable to keep on going. And another thing that we are going to talk, it's how much this affects on regulating the nervous system, right? I don't know if that should be between meditation and breathing or...
Also a very broad topic. I think the most important thing in terms of breath and the nervous system is, you know, that excited state. You know, we're always in this excited state. And if our nervous system is always in this excited state, it tends to throw a lot of things off, particularly our endocrine system, which is, you know, the system that sort of regulates all of our hormones in the body that signal just about everything for us. So if your nervous system is always in a heightened state, it tends to almost fry our bodies. You know, you can, I myself have had some nervous system issues, and I can feel my body almost fried, like my brain, my body's not functioning well. I can't get in and out of situations, whether it be a relaxed state or an excited state. And I think that's really the most important thing. Our bodies ought to be more fluid. And if we are always in this excitatory state, and our nervous system is always heightened, we're unable to relax. And that's when, you know, breathing sort of coaches us in ways to sort of find a more relaxed state, and that way calming our nervous system down and back into our, you know, parasympathetic nervous system.
Oh, this is great what you're saying. I was watching one of the Wim Hof podcasts, I think it was the last one, and he said so many people, especially towards athletic performance competition, so many people are so focused on their body, on becoming stronger and faster, and not really caring about the connection between the body and the mind. Because who is into sports, or even though, like before that interview to the Brazilian channel, like if you're not in a good mental state, if you're gonna compete or whatever you're gonna do, you're nervous, you're gonna shake, you're not gonna perform as well.
Yeah.
And that click you gave in my head, how much breathing helps you to control this nervous system better, to me this is like clear as water.
Yeah. Yeah, it's about being able to get from one state to another state. You know, a lot of people look at, let's say, massage therapy or even any of these relaxation techniques as something to just recover, when actually it helps you perform better in these excitatory states. So in the capacity upon which you can relax will directly influence your capacity to get excited. So it's about that fluctuation that we need to be able to access. You know, the ebb and flow of our entire systems is really what leads us more to a more optimal state. You know, if we're always in this heightened state and we're unable to relax, then how much higher can you go? And then this higher becomes your normal, and yet there's no capacity for you to go up or down. So it's really about that fluid movement and being able to get excited and also knowing how to relax at the same time. So it's far beyond recovery. It really helps to sort of access greater capacity in all functions and all functionings in all systems.
We were talking about that during our session, right? That
you
said you said
about
you spoke a little bit about Bruce Lee, or towards me, not trying to go up the mountain so hard if you can go around.
Yes.
And yeah, this makes so much sense.
Yeah, you know, I think we're programmed to be like go-getters, and if we don't give everything our all, somebody's gonna get there before us. You know, yet is where are we really trying to go? You know, but the only place that we're really trying to go is within ourselves, and you know, how can we be better in this moment? You know, not how can we get to the next moment. How can we be better in this moment?
Alignment therapist is very good, right? And you don't even have an idea. You know, people don't even have an idea that there's a professional like her out there. And I found out about Geraldine when I used to work on this very high level gym here in New York City. I'm not sure if I can say their name. But I was looking into who was the best muscle release therapist I could find in the city, what these high-level people in the fitness industry could recommend. And all of them kept saying, Geraldine. I was like, who is this person? I have to find this person. Because by that time, I was learning about muscle release and how much you can do for your clients, especially if they are under like a lower back pain, shoulder pain, neck pain or something. Because there is this misconception that you have pain, you shouldn't exercise or you shouldn't do anything, just rest or take muscle relaxers or anything for pain. But there is so much that you can do in a holistic way, right? Mm-hmm. So attaching to this subject, when I say therapist alignment, let's go a little bit towards this muscular pain. So if the joint of the body is out of alignment, it's going to cause you pain,
sure.
Right?
Yes.
So this is what you try to work on the sessions on?
If we were to talk about alignment altogether, it really encompasses a lot of things. It's just, how do you carry your body in space? How do you move your body in space? If a joint is misaligned, it could be for a number of reasons. It could have been from a traumatic incident. It could have been from a shortened muscle. It could be from anything. So how do you address joint misalignment? In my scope of practice, it's not something that I'm able to address. However, when I work with soft tissues, sometimes it does allow a joint to actually go back into place. So alignment has a lot to do with everything. And when I call myself an alignment therapist, it's really how we are aligned with ourselves. So not just in the physical state, and it's also an emotional state and all aspects, spiritual even. So if we're just talking physically, however, we're working the muscle tissue and the soft tissue to be able to work more optimally. So everything works in polarities. We have muscles that are agonists and antagonists, and they work in this healthy relationship. You know, there's a push-pull action happening within our body, or else how would we move, how would we stand, so on and so forth. So if one muscle is extra short, you know, the other antagonist muscle may be over-lengthened and unable to work in a more efficient manner. So in our work, we try to correct the alignment by addressing this imbalance. And so we look at relationships. We never just address a single area. If a muscle is tight, I don't just release that muscle. I need to identify, why is that muscle tight? What is that muscle working for? And how is it allowing this client to move? And how can we improve?
Exactly. I'm gonna try to say in a simpler version, mm-hmm. And you correct me anytime. And I'm gonna use myself as comparison. I used to play handball for many years, sitting down in front of the computer under stress and getting tired, and then I started feeling shoulder pain, right? So what was one of the best alternatives was seeing someone like Geraldine to work on releasing the muscles in the front of my chest, on top of here, my neck, and I focus on working more the muscles on the back, on my back, to get the shoulder more aligned, in a proper alignment, right? Mm-hmm. And that can happen in your hips, in your knee, in your ankle, in your spine, and cause different pains, right?
It can lower happen pain,
anywhere. And that's what I love to people to understand, that hadn't heard about this yet, that through muscle release that you can do trigger point that you can do on your own, or you know, find someone good to work on muscle release, and then you work on strengthening the right muscles to get that joint in a better alignment, you can get pain free.
Yes.
Some people go towards surgery on the last case scenario because they ignored the pain signal for some time, and then or something worse happened too fast. And you know, this is another question. Is like, if this joint is out of alignment and you did a surgery to recover that tendon or ligament, whatever happened, and the shoulder is out of alignment, you know, this person probably is gonna go through a surgery again, right? If you don't fix that alignment or that movement or whatever it is.
Yeah, so if we were to look, you're mentioning the shoulder. So if we were to look at the shoulder and let's say the mechanics of that shoulder are poor to the point where it causes a dysfunction, and it doesn't, there's no correction in place, it can cause structural damage. You know, you can develop bone spurs, you can tear ligaments, you can pull a muscle when you try to do a movement that's an opposite of a shortened area. There's so many things that can happen if the mechanics are not sort of maximized or improved. So if someone goes into surgery because they now have a torn labrum or a torn supraspinatus tendon, it can help because it can take them out of that immediate sense of pain and discomfort. But if the mechanics are not improved and that client or patient is not, you know, sort of shown a way to move more efficiently, then it can repeat itself. So it's really important to not look for quick fixes, and you know, things take time. And I think people are so disconnected with themselves and also impatient. You know, again, we live in a society where we want everything yesterday, that we're not willing to work on these things. And when we start labeling things as bad shoulder, then we don't want to pay attention to that bad shoulder. You know, it's not something that they want to keep revisiting because it encompasses so much of their lives. And you know, you have the surgery and it's like, okay, I'm supposed to be better, I'm going to be better. However, if you just take the time to get to know your body and how you're moving in space and how can you improve that and how can you feel better, and you know, the capacity to improve is endless for everyone. you know, wherever we are in life, there's always a way to sort of be more present in that experience and improve.
Yeah, these clicks are amazing, right? I should pay her for every click, but then I would have one dime in my pocket. I'm going to connect all of these now, like the stress, the shallow breathing. We didn't speak much about the exercises, but like everybody, not everybody, but exercise helps a lot for you to dealing with this stress and releasing your body understands in an easy way that I understood. So you think you're in danger, you think you're in danger, or when you're exercising, right, you're running, your body think you're in danger, then you're kind of like, I don't want to do this, exercise, I hate exercising, whatever, but you're done, you feel so good, you're so happy, life is so amazing, right, you're so grateful to be alive, because your body understands, like, you survived through something, you know, like, the danger you were into, you survived, so this is great for someone that is dealing with depression, whatever it is, for different. So someone that is under stress, that doesn't exercise often, shallow breathing, or living in a tough city like New York City, away from the contact with nature. People are miserable, honestly. People are miserable, and that's okay, that's normal. And I wanna get into a deeper subject, that's depression, right? So let's talk a little bit about depression, if you can bring some light into how much of that is genetic and how much, like, you know, we can do for it.
You know, I think we can sort of circle back a lot of the things that we've already talked about. When you talk about genetics, it's not necessarily, I mean, there could definitely be a chemical imbalance, you know. Again, it's something that's very fluid. It's not like you cannot correct this chemical imbalance. And you can, it's not like you cannot correct it without medicine either. You know, there are so many things that you can do to sort of alter your brain chemistry to sort of improve your outlook and the way you feel. Just like you said with exercise and how it improves your mental state. There's so many hormones that are released during exercise that help you feel good, which is why people tend to feel good. And a lot of times you can't even feel pain. You know, someone could be running a marathon on a bum ankle, but yet they don't feel the pain in their ankle because their adrenaline is running through their, coursing through their veins. So this goes back to how our bodies protect us. So if in our mind we need to run 26.2 miles, we're not going to let that ankle bother us. We're going to be feeling good and we're going to push through it. So it's just a matter of how our body responds to how we think and feel about our body. Now, if we want to talk about depression in general, I was reading the other day that the World Health Organization by 2030 are predicting that depression is going to be the number one state of health condition that impacts us all. It's going to actually surpass obesity. Now, when we consider our lifestyle, like again, what we have mentioned with the amount of information out there, with social media, with the, you know, political sort of agendas that we are all experiencing wherever we are, and just the daily demand, there's this feeling that we are so stressed out that we don't know what to do about it. You know, do we exercise more? And generally then that doesn't necessarily improve situations either, because that can cause a lot of physiological stress on the body as opposed to the psychological stress or emotional stress that we're experiencing. So there are so many things coming at us that a lot of times we feel overwhelmed. It impacts our sleep, it impacts our breath. So we feel so overwhelmed that it influences our mental state. And depression has become more common. And you hear about people who are experiencing more anxiety because of the amount of stress. I think so many people are on anti-anxiety meds and really trying to address things medicinally because you're not so sure as to how to approach all of these things that are coming at us at this speed that it is. You know, it's not like we can go back to living a normal life where we work, you know, 9 to 5 and we come home and we cook dinner and we sit down and eat dinner as a family and we only work Monday through Friday. And the simple life is certainly in the past, and we have this world that's open to us. You know, there's so many things that I can talk about in terms of wellness and when the word wellness sort of came about and why, you know, back in the 70s, because all of this information that was coming our way. You know, we have access to people across the world now in seconds. So our world feels like it's getting smaller because of our access to so much more. And it's such a positive thing, but yet we feel the negative impact of it, because we are unable to have a better relationship with ourselves.
Yes.
I think if we just empower ourselves more through breath and exercise, the quality of life, the things that we have around us, people close to us, interpersonal relationships, all of these things that support a good quality of life, you know, all of the things that happen around us are going to be more beneficial than it is hurtful. You know, having access to anything and everything should be an amazing thing. You know, I tend to be a bookworm. I read a lot. I'm such an introvert. I enjoy being home and researching a lot of things. And to me, like, gaining access to all this information is an exciting thing, but yet it also feels overwhelming. So we have to know when to pull back. We have to know when to utilize it to our advantage and not disadvantage. So again, it comes back to really knowing ourselves. And I think that's where people are missing, because we almost forgot how to have a conversation, like looking at each other in the eye and the value of touch. And we've sort of built this wall around us. And social media has created this fake, not fake, but this unreal understanding that we are connected, when we're really not.
You're not. We are inside of the elevator, everybody on their own phone,
yes,
right? Or
yes,
sitting in front of TV,
yes,
watching TV, not even having a conversation between the husband and the wife.
Yes, and people are more inclined to post how they feel as opposed to tell somebody how they feel, or even, you know, tell themselves how they feel. And you know, you see it all the time. And not to say that it's a bad thing, but it's how we are adapting. And now, call me idealistic, but I sense a change happening. You know, people are starting to really pay attention to what matters to them the most. People are starting to understand that it's important for me to connect with people. People are starting to understand that we need to turn our phones off. People are starting to understand we need to not watch so much TV. You know, all of these things, again, is something that is making us pay better attention. So, you know, I see the direction changing. In the beginning, because we were just like bombarded with all this stuff, and then we didn't know how to deal with it, and we sort of like rode the wave and like got really excited about it to the point where we didn't know how to relax anymore. And now everyone is looking for ways to relax. How do we wind down? How do we give back to ourselves? How do we choose what foods to eat? How do we get better sleep? You know, what is this meditation thing? Like, everyone is really hungry for ways to sort of learn how to get back to that rested state. So it's great for me, because, you know, as a massage therapist, body worker, wellness practitioner, whatever you want to call me, it excites me to hear people looking for better ways to sort of get in touch with themselves again.
Yes, I remember one of our sessions in the past. I came to you and I was very overwhelmed. New York City is very different from Brazil. People are here more introspective. They don't really want to talk. If you talk to them, it's like, why are you talking to me? Then I became a mom. I was very lonely in the beginning, questioning myself with my career and my future. And then I would exercise to feel good, but always with that, you know, not being able to experience myself and breathe and learn how to calm down. And you brought so much light every time I saw you. I'm so grateful. But I want to get to this now, because breathing was a big step, and it's still a big step. As you told me, the big challenge for myself now is to keep it consistent, you know, to keep on remembering on breathing. But another thing that has been making a huge change in who I am is meditation. My God. We were talking before the interview, and Geraldine thinks like she has not a different opinion. She gave me a lot of light over it. But to me, when people used to talk about meditation, I was like, oh, how boring. Oh my God, I don't want to do that. And then when I started trying to do, it was just so hard to turn off my mind. Oh my God, what? Stay there and not think on anything? Oh my God, how hard is that? It still is. Oh my, sometimes it still is. But anything in life, you gotta be persistent. You gotta put the focus on. But you said the other side, that maybe meditation scares some people because
so many things come up for you. when you silence your mind, you know, you sort of start seeing all of the things that you may be suppressing or hiding or tucking away or saving for later or hoping you'll forget, but you never do. You know, our subconscious thoughts sort of influence especially our reactionary state. And understanding our subconscious is very important for us to be able to gain a better perspective of life, and which is why meditation is so important, because you can gain access to these things that control our behaviors that we don't really know. Like, you know, why do I respond in that way to that person? Why do I feel this way about what they said? All of that are sort of subconscious behaviors, and it could have been something that may have been planted when we were a child, or something that happened to us in the past, or a traumatic event. And all of these things sort of are tucked away because, you know, our brain thinks that it needs to keep it there to sort of protect us, or it's there because we haven't been able to face something, because we may not have felt safe enough or able to. Well, when we meditate, we gain access to these areas, and it could be very frightening. You know, when people think about meditation, they think that it's like, you know, butterflies and rainbows and unicorns, when sometimes it's some of the most toughest thing, it's the toughest thing you can do. You know, being able to do nothing, to get to the place where you're absolutely doing nothing, is the hardest thing to do. To shut off, not even shut off your thoughts, to be able to recognize your thoughts, understand why you're having these thoughts and these thought patterns. Why are you thinking this way? And what am I giving myself with these thoughts? And are they real? Is it the truth? Like, all of these questions start coming up for you. And, you know, I feel like everyone needs to understand that we're all capable of anything. And so when these things come up and we start to scare ourselves, it's really just asking us to take a look at something and to really ask ourselves, like, is this something that I feel that is true, or is this like a false belief? And being able to confront these false beliefs is one of the toughest things ever. You know, a lot of times our subconscious behaviors that that inner sabotage when we try to do something, right? And we want to gain access to something, yet we can't do it because we don't think we're good enough, or we don't think we're able to, and we try really hard, and we get to this point, and all of a sudden we stop ourselves.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, so why do I feel this way? Is there something that happened in my life that makes me feel this way? And is it true? You know, if you just ask yourself, like, is that true? And most of the time it's not. So
just a perspective.
It's a perspective, and one that sort of may have protected you in the past, but you may not need that now. So it's important to be brave enough to encounter these things and address these things. And you can do it in small bites, you know, a little bit at a time. And it's a process. You know, I'm still going through the process. I think we all are still going through this process. It takes a lot of time.
When you said sabotage, I just came up with something in my mind. I have to say, to explain myself, it's just sometimes you're like, you know, you shouldn't eat anything after dinner, but like, no, I deserve just one little candy, and then you just can't stop eating. You're sabotaging yourself with your mind. But it was very shallow to comparison. But so anyway, G, what's your best recommendation to someone that wants to start meditating? Let me just fix something here.
You know, I think there are different things everyone can try. One thing I recommend to people is like a meditation app. I think for you, when you first began,
yes,
I recommended
Headspace. I started with Headspace.
Yeah, and so I think that's a good place to start. It's user friendly. It's cute. It's interesting. It's guided. So you
it's
don't.
It's for
have
free.
To.
The 10 first sessions is for free.
Yeah, and you don't have to think about anything. It kind of walks you through it. Mm-hmm. It holds your hand. Mm-hmm. I think that's a good way for some people to start. The other way that I suggest for people is just to, again, take 3 to 5 breaths in the morning, 3 to 5 breaths in the evening, practice your breathing in the shower. In those moments where you're actually focusing on yourself, those are also meditative experiences. Or, you know, as you get further advanced, you can do other things where you're actually sitting in silence and you actually get to explore, you know, different levels of where your brain can take you.
Yes, to me, Headspace was very good as a beginning, but what really changed, like, things very fast, let's say, that's very relative to every person, but was the Wim Hof Method. So there are some things that happened that in my life that really made a twist. One of them was meeting you. One of them, not in that order, the first one is having a baby, but then meeting Geraldine, and the Wim Hof Method. So I wanted to talk about that because it's a mix of meditation, right? And mm-hmm. breathing and cold showers. And I think there's a lot of people starting to do it and a little lost. I got lost a lot. I was texting her as crazy, like, Geraldine, this happened to me. What's going on?
She thought she was dying.
Yeah, oh my God. I thought I was so overwhelmed with everything that I was feeling.
Yeah.
To someone that is like, was in the dark, not in the dark, but didn't know about these things of the lights that you see lights. I get off, how many times I got off of the shower and I told Philip, you don't know what happened to me, and I'm like, I'm shocked. And you told me, start doing it sitting down or laying down under the shower, so, because it's kind of dangerous. It's crazy, but it's amazing. You gotta look into this, guy, if you haven't yet. So let's talk a little bit about that, mm-hmm. about these lights. What are the lights?
Oh gosh, what are the lights?
They're sometimes coming out of my body or around my head. I'm like, oh my God, what's going on?
I think from my perspective, now this is experiential in terms of my own experience. The lights, from what I understand, is when your brain starts to release certain hormones or chemicals. And for example, DMT. When DMT is released, you have a super conscious experience or out-of-body experience. And this is sort of where the lights lead you to. The lights essentially is just the initial stage of it. And then after that light stage, you actually feel out of body. Now, it takes process and progress and persistence and consistency and complete mindfulness to get to this state, and then also a preparation for it. You know, you can't sit down after a long day of work and try to gain access to this because your body is not prepped for this, which is why the Wim Hof Method is really interesting, because it also includes a breathing technique also known in the yogic world as pranayama. So it has a lot to do with like the breath of fire and that rapid breathing where you're actually using the diaphragm to increase the oxygen intake in your brain, and now you get into this capacity where you see these lights. Now once you see these lights, then you go into this space where you actually don't feel your body anymore, and it's pretty cool. Now,
when I see the lights, I'm like, I remember you saying it's after the lights, and like, I think, and then it's gone.
Yeah.
But I feel good.
No,
but I'm going to get there.
It's a process.
It's a process.
And again, it's not about, which is another reason why Wim Hof technique is really great, because it works well for these extremists like you. Because, you know, you even turned meditation into a sport, an extreme sport. You know, it's like, let me get to the lights. And it's like, yeah, once you're there, it's like, I'm there. But, you know, as opposed to just letting it happen. And I told her, like, when you see the lights, you know, that's just the beginning. Just don't go looking for it. Don't have any judgment or understanding of it. Just the do nothing part, you know, just once it arrives, just do nothing. And it's the most exciting thing, because not everybody gets there on their own. You know, you can get help. You know, they actually have synthetic DMT that you can take, and other plant medicines that you can take that sort of can help this experience, which a lot of people are taking, because it can actually help you gain a different perspective of life. It helps to deal with anxiety, post-traumatic stress disorder, a number of conditions, it can help with addiction as well. So many things in terms of what this experience can offer you, because we are so much more than this physical vehicle.
Yeah.
You know, this physical vehicle is actually a gift for us to experience these things. So when we honor it and we respect it and we develop a good relationship with it and we cultivate these type of practices, we can experience the true nature of what we're meant to experience in this world, which is the capacity to know that there's so much more out there.
Yes, I'm just going to get this comparison a little bit with the athletic side, because this is what I really like experienced almost my whole life. I do feel it. I feel it. I feel it more energy. I feel I can run faster. I feel great after the meditation, or I see the lights, or after the Wim Hof. When I'm able to see the lights, oh my God, that's the best day of my life. I don't need anything else. I'm great. I'm ready to go. And there is the oxygenation side too, right? That fully alkalinizes your body, right?
Yes.
So to some people that don't understand this alkaline is so good. Drink lemon water is so good to alkalinize the body. So just in a fast way that I think it's a little easy to understand, the body, it's most made of water, right? We have most water in the body. And if you think in an aquarium, the water has to be alkaline so the fishes live in it. If it's too acidic, they're gonna die, like a polluted river or something. There is no life in it because it's highly acidic. So that's how you would like your body to be, or in a neutral pH level or alkaline. So everything works better, your digestion, everything. You don't want to be more than the acidic. If you drink too much, if you eat too much junk food, if you coffee can bring to the acidic side, some other stuff. But anyway, when you do the breathing, you fully alkalinize your body, mm-hmm. Right?
Yes.
That's one of the things that I feel with the Wim Hof Method. Like I'm woof, like I'm recharged, I'm filled with energy, I'm ready to go, everything's working great.
It's better than a cup of coffee.
Yeah, it is a better.
You might not agree.
I'm letting it go. I'm letting go my coffee. My body sometimes rejects it. Is there anything else we should talk about that we haven't?
I don't know.
Unfortunately, we can't talk and look to the message, especially I don't have my glasses on, so I gotta do something like this. But I think that's it, right? Oh, before, how can people find you?
it's my website, GeraldineAbergas.com. So it's Geraldine, last name Abergas. There's a capacity where you can sign on and sign up for my newsletter or send me a message, and mm-hmm. we can stay connected. I have a lot of projects in motion, and I'm hoping to be able to offer more information and support for people out there. It's about time I get out of the treatment room and start engaging more with others. So I'm looking forward to sharing more. So go to my website, go to my Facebook page, follow me on Instagram.
She's always posting on Instagram. I love your posts. They always
Thank
bring
you.
A different light to my day. Yes.
Thank you.
There is one thing. The question, so I'm gonna do this question every time I interview someone, and that was a click from her. So what is the one thing people should do every day that would be beneficial to themselves?
Take a guess.
Breathing?
Yes.
I thought it when I got it right. Breathing, okay.
Yeah, you know, it's something you can do anywhere, everywhere, whenever you want, on the subway, walking, before you go to bed, in the shower, any moments at all. If you were to just check in with your breath, take in a nice big breath, a nice exhalation, you know, you can progress from there and start even holding your breath. There's so many different breathing methods out there. You know, there's different counts that you can utilize. So don't get confused with all of the information that's out there regarding breathing. It's more about how you're breathing in that moment and how can you make it a little bit better. So whatever it may be, gaining greater access to your abdominal breathing, gaining more access to 360-degree breathing, or just breathing at all, I think it's really important. It's like, just take a breath whenever you can. Just take a nice big breath and a nice exhalation. And you just feel better from it, you know? So it's like instant. It's instant and easy, and it'll help improve your life. And the more you practice it, just like any muscle that you train, you need to train your breathing as well. And I think if everybody were to just gain greater access to their breath, we're all going to be happier people.
I feel it. I feel it. Gee, thank you so much for doing this
thank
with me.
You.
And that's it. This episode is going to be available on the podcast, right? I'm going to post soon the right link for you to access. It's going to be available on iTunes too. So let's keep in touch. And I'll see you next time for sure.
Thank you everyone for watching.
Thank you. Oh, thank you so much.
Thank you.
This is priceless.
Thank you.
Let's see how to turn this off now.